Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Welcome to St. John's. We're going to have another pretty day, I think. Hope so. Today we have the announcements. These announcements are the St. John CPR classes. The next Heart Saver class is October 17 after worship. Contact Aaron Slates if you have any questions. There's been a tree cut down near the pavilion, as everybody knows. The wood is still available if anybody's interested in getting wood. The crop walk updates. I want to thank you to everyone who donated to the crop walk with offerings totaling $363.53. This money will go to help to fight the hunger globally and locally. Call committee update. The next meeting for the call committee is October 18 at 7 p.m. At this meeting, they will continue to work on the ministry site profile report, which will be submitted to the Senate. Trunk or treat and campfire. This is Saturday, 10th, October 23rd at 6 p.m. Trunk or treat will be in the church parking lot, and everyone from St. John and the public is welcome. A sign-up sheet is available in the narthex for campfire hot dogs and items to make s'mores. Bring your lawn chair and hot dog treats. Hot dog sticks, I'm sorry, not treats. Indoor worship help needed. We always need help in indoor worship. Volunteers are necessary to help during the weekly indoor worship each week. Helping those in need for the homeless, we need support for this cause continues. Food pantry needs, we need that also. Are there any other announcements? Yes.
I see this note about the bell ringers. John, did you mention about the bell choir?
The bell choir.
It's going to meet this Wednesday at 6 p.m. for the first rehearsal. New ringers are welcome. No, it's written here, John. You didn't miss it. It was, yeah. I just saw it, so. I'm here to talk this morning briefly about the COVID tests that Kathy was passing around. Everybody has them. If not, can you hear me okay? We need to thank Kathy for getting these. These are the same ones I've been told that Ohio State Hospital are using. Testing kits are getting hard to obtain, and they're about $25 each on up. So we are lucky these are free to us. So all you really need to have to use this is a computer with a webcam, smartphone, tablet of some sort, email address, and an internet connection. This is an antigen test. Antigens are proteins that hook onto a germ. And so in this case, it would be the coronavirus. So if antigens are present, the person probably has COVID then. This is a rapid test. It takes 15 minutes. It's really easy to use. It involves a nasal swab. And first you put some drops in a card, and then you put a swab in your nose, and it's only a half inch to 3/4 inch. It's not very far in. You twirl it 5 times. You do the other side, twirl it 5 times, and then you stick it in the card and wait 15 minutes. So it's very easy to do. And Kathy's given you a piece of paper, too, that has some instructions on it. I recommend, and what I did before I did the test on myself, I went to emed.com, and there they ask you to start testing, and then I did that, and then it asks you which state you're in, and I put Ohio, and then what happens, the next little screen, it pops up a 2-minute video, and the video shows you just what is involved, and it kind of gets you familiar with what's going to happen. And so it's not really too big of a deal. They want you, and the box says clearly here, download the Navica app. They want you to create an account with them, and the reason for this is that the test results are recorded. And a lot of people need to have a negative test to go back to work, or to go into some places. Even some cruises are accepting these test results. So you set up a Navica app, and then when you go into Navica, it'll say, it puts you in a digital waiting room. So you're in this waiting room, and next thing that happens comes a person who will be your guide. They will walk you through it step by step, and they also will verify your results. So these results are saved. Navica saves them, and you can pull them up at a later time should you need to show them to anybody. These tests are great for, like I said, cruises, getting back to work if the facility accepts this kind of test, and these are pretty well accepted. It's also helpful if you're going to go visit your grandkids and you want to know that you're okay. It's helpful if you're going to spend the holidays with your family and you want to know that you're okay or somebody in your family's okay. Very simple to do. There is an expiration date on the box, and it says, mine says September 17th, but they have extended the expiration date 90 days, so these are okay to use. Something else, if you wake up one morning and you got a runny nose, you're sniffing and you're not sure what's going on, doesn't necessarily mean you have to run to the test, because there's a limited supply of these tests. If you're not running a fever, don't have a cough, not short of breath, maybe you could wait the 24 hours and the next day check yourself out and see. But anytime you're having shortness of breath, a cough, running a fever, you probably need to think about running the test and seeking medical attention. One thing about these tests, let's say you do a test and it comes back negative. The next couple days you start getting more shortness of breath, increased fever, cough. You probably need to put a mask on, isolate yourself a little bit, and contact your doctor. Anytime you have shortness of breath, you need to contact your doctor. But every now and then you can get a false negative test. So that's why if you get a negative test but your symptoms are getting worse, you need to seek medical attention. That's all I have on this. Any questions? I did it, so I know you can do it. It really is, it's pretty slick how these work, and it only takes 15 minutes. Kathy, is there anything I'm missing there? Okay, any questions? I think they have to be, it says store between 35.6 to 86 degrees until use. It's right on the box there. Yeah, everything you need is in this box. That's all I have. Okay, thank you. Yes.
Why do we need a webcam?
Because the person, your guide, is going to be watching you, and you have to show the results to the person so they can verify your results. Otherwise, the results are not verified, and an employee or a cruise ship or whoever would not accept them. And plus, they'll give you step-by-step instructions. Yes, yes. Anything else? Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Barb. We will continue with the prelude.
Thank you.
Good morning, St. John Lutheran Church.
Good morning.
It is good to be with all of you in person and online. Just a couple things for today. You will notice there will be no children's time today, and our acolyte will be sitting in the congregation. My lovely daughter, Elizabeth, got sick this week. Thanks to that, we all had to get COVID tests. We're all negative, but she does have a common cold that she caught from a family member on Matt's side. So out of abundance of caution for our kids and for all of you, nobody else is gonna be up here with me today. So that's the first announcement. Then next week, I will not be here because I have to go to my own Synod Assembly all the way in Morgantown, West Virginia. And so we will have a lay leader from this congregation leading worship here. It'll be a service of the word, no communion next week, so just so you're aware of that. And then the only thing I was going to say as a follow-up to what Barb said regarding COVID testing, a lot of employers right now, if you have a family member that even gets sick, you are required to get tested, even for a runny nose. And so before we went to get our official test, we tried to go to three different stores in Strongsville to get these home tests. They don't have them. So what you have in your hands is precious commodity. Please use it diligently. It's better to have it than not have it if you're on the cusp and you're not sure. And if you do have to get tested, for those of us who've had to get tested, it's not hard. It's a swab up the nose. It doesn't hurt. So if you can't get the home test or you use the home test and you have to go get tested, I mean, literally it takes not even 5 minutes. And then if it's the rapid test, you'll have those results within an hour or 15 minutes. So just so you're aware of that. So, otherwise this morning I will be using my voice very sparingly because I also have laryngitis, so that's really exciting. One other thing I wanted to announce today, after the service I will be leaving you all. Please keep Christ Lutheran Church in Vienna, West Virginia, the church I left. They have called a new pastor, Reverend Tom Darr, out of York, Pennsylvania. He will be installed this afternoon at 4 o'clock. And so I will be driving 3 hours down, 3 hours back. But please keep their congregation in your prayers. And because they were just in a call process like you all are right now. So we give thanks to God for that as well. So with that, I invite you to stand as we begin with the confession of forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose teaching is life, whose presence is sure, and whose love is endless.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins to the one who welcomes us with an open heart. God, our comforter, like lost sheep, we have gone astray. We gaze upon abundance and see scarcity. We turn our faces away from injustice and oppression. We exploit the earth with apathy and greed. Free us from our sin, gracious God. Listen when we call out to you for help. Lead us by your love to love our neighbors as ourselves. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. By the grace, gift of grace in Christ Jesus, God makes you righteous. Receive, glad hearts, the forgiveness of all your sins. Amen. Amen. We continue with our gathering hymn found in your Lutheran Book of Worship, your green hymnals, hymn 250, verses 1 and 2. Hymn 250, verses 1 and 2. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, increase in us your gift of faith, that forsaking that lies behind and reaching out to what lies ahead, we may follow the way of your commandments and receive the crown of everlasting joy. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated for scripture readings.
Today I'll be reading the Old Testament, Amos 5, verses 6 to 7 and 10 to 15. Amos 5. Seek the Lord, and he will break out against the house of Joseph like a fire, and will devour Bethel with no one to quench it. Ah, you that turn justice to wormwood and bring righteousness to the ground. They hate the one who reproves in the gate, and they abhor the one who speaks the truth. Therefore, because you trample on the poor and take from them levies of grain, you have built houses of hewn stone, but you shall not live in them. You have planted pleasant vineyards, but you shall not drink their wine. For I know how many are your transgressions and how great are your sins. You who afflict the righteous, you who take a bribe and push aside the needy in the gate. Therefore, the prudent will keep silent in such a time, for it is an evil time. Seek good and not evil, that you may live. And so the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you, just as you have said. Hate evil and love good, and establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. Thanks be to God. Our New Testament reading is Hebrews 4, verses 12 to 16. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And before him, no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who is who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. This is the Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 10th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own, give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Lord, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly, I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive a hundredfold now in this age, houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last shall be first." This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Can you all hear me okay? Because this is the best I can do here. Grace and peace to you from our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Here we gather together on the road to Jerusalem with Jesus. Here we kneel before the Lord, our Creator, Christ, our Redeemer, and the Holy Spirit, our Sanctifier, in a posture of need for healing and wholeness from a deeply seated and deeply rooted disconnection that afflicts all of us in this time and place, and has afflicted the generations prior to us and those to come after us. As we hear today's gospel reading, when taking Jesus' words at face value, pretty much makes all of us uncomfortable this morning. Anyone with me on that one? Anyone giving up all their wealth today? Right? Because by ourselves alone, it is impossible. But as Jesus said, but through God, all things are possible. Here we gather together, kneeling alongside our brother, the rich man that kneels before Jesus. And here is an invitation from Jesus Christ in today's gospel reading from Mark 10, verses 17 through 31. To healing. But as any person can tell you, all healing involves some form of discomfort. All right? It's like this week when my daughter got sick with her first common cold. I felt helpless like a mother for like 20 seconds. I was like, "What do you want me to do?" And she can't tell me yet, you know? Like, she just has to go through it. I can't do anything but comfort her. And that's what we have going on in this gospel reading for today. Because the gospel of Jesus Christ is to bring comfort, but it also afflicts the comfortable. Right? The gospel brings comfort, but it also afflicts the comfortable. And this affliction eventually leads us to understand the root of our disconnection with God and with one another. But again, through God, all things are possible. When we step out and allow ourselves to grow in that uncomfortableness. In today's gospel reading, Jesus encounters a rich man on his way to Jerusalem. The rich man does not have a name. We don't know what he owned. Clearly, he is afflicted and in need of healing, thus taking the posture of kneeling before Jesus. Initially, it might seem that the demand Jesus places on this rich man's life and really, for the matter upon any of us, is downright impossible. It might seem like this, but keep in mind what Jesus is demanded to do in obedience to his Heavenly Father is much greater than what we are demanded to do, as Jesus gives his very life for the world, even for that rich man kneeling before him. The rich man pleads with Jesus, "I've kept the law, right? I've kept the commandments." The man clings to the law of Moses, the Torah, like a child clings to a teddy bear or a blanket. Yet, if this were true, and the rich man were satisfied with his life, and truly believed he was following the law, then why ask Jesus, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" Right? I mean, doesn't that seem a little strange to you? If I thought everything was right, I wouldn't be going asking that. Why bother to come to Jesus in the first place? Why not keep doing what he's doing? So many unanswered questions. I would argue that something was stirred up in the rich man. We know from the New Testament, especially in the Gospels, each time a person kneels before Jesus pleading, they know they are in need of some change of heart or mind, some form of healing, even if they cannot articulate it upon their own lips. Jesus knows what is on the man's heart and mind. He reminds him of the commandments. The rich man indicates he's kept all these since his youth. And then the tiny detail that gets lost in this gospel reading, Jesus looks at the rich man, and it says, "And he loved him." Did anyone pick up on that this morning? It's a tiny little line in there. He looked at the rich man, loved him, and said to him, "You lack one thing. Go sell what you own, give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." You see, this rich man in the first century would have had been a property owner. He would have owned slaves, people he owned to take care of his properties. Selling all of his possessions would have included selling the slaves. The slaves don't stop being slaves, they just get sold to another household family. But the money and wealth from those sales could have been used to help the slaves beneath him. And Jesus is making an important point with the rich man in this reality. For Jesus to be a follower in God's kingdom, you can't say you keep the law, but then in your words and in your actions, do something like own people, right? See a disconnect there? Or use your wealth to keep other people down below you. I mean, so often in our society, we hear money is the root of evil. It's not the money itself. It's what people do with the money, right? And you don't have to be rich. Right? I grew up poor. I saw a lot of poor people. We did a lot of stuff too to other people. You can't just say you keep the law and then harm other people. Because when we do that, we do it also against God. And there's no room for this in God's kingdom. We can't say we trust God and then continue to want to be in the driver's seat of control and do things the way we want them in God's kingdom. It just doesn't square. Nonetheless, Jesus still invites this rich man for an opportunity to be healed of his deep-seated separation from God and neighbor. With love, he looks upon the rich man and offers the rich man an opportunity to choose to do something different that will root him in what it truly means to be a disciple, a follower of Jesus Christ. We don't know what happens to the rich man after this. This account is in all four Gospels, and we never hear what happens afterwards, other than he goes away shocked and grieving, for he had many possessions. Literally, the world as he understood it up to this point is now turned upside down in God's kingdom. To inherit the kingdom of God isn't about turning the law into a checklist of stuff, right? I can't take my Ten Commandments this week and go, well, did this one, check this one, I think I'm good, right? Or if I take communion up here, the joke Matt and I always says, Matt said to me one year, he had to go to 3 services in one day with me as a spouse. He said, well, that should cover me for the whole year, right? My colleague in West Virginia was like, try again. If you have that thought, you've already sinned. To be part of the kingdom of God is to be in solidarity with Christ and to be in solidarity with our neighbors. And as I said last week, it's about relationships. God is a God of relationships. God desires for life for all of us. And therefore, we also have that opportunity to give life back to one another, not take it away. But the other thing about this rich man today is that prior getting into the discussion about the commandments and the law, he calls Jesus the good teacher. Anyone pick up on that? And Jesus immediately says, why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. In those days, and even today, being good is associated with being blessed. The more good you are, the more blessed you are. Just ask Joel Wolstein, right? And then send your, like, big contribution to whatever fund. The more blessed you are, the more successful you will be. All indicators that you're a good person. None of this has to do with trusting God and Jesus Christ. For those of you at St. John who have been with me for a few funerals around here, you will notice that I am very careful at funeral services as a pastor about using the word good. Because as I told Matt, someday I will die, either before him or after him. And if at my funeral somebody says, well, I'm good, well, that's baloney. It's baloney because I can't be good all the time, right? None of us can. I remember doing a funeral one time out of state, and we had a situation. I was on internship, and a mistress showed up at the funeral that nobody knew about. Pastor's going on about how good the person was. It was not good. It was not good. She talked out. She let the whole church know. When I'm in those moments as a pastor, my job is to preach Christ crucified and risen at a funeral. It's not my job to preach the person and say how good they were, and that's why God loves them. They may be a good person, but we're all saints and sinners. And the reason God loves that person and all of us isn't about our goodness or badness, or our achievements and successes or failures. God loves us because of who God is. That person, a beloved son and daughter of God, is unconditionally loved and forgiven by God in Jesus Christ, not based on their works or good deeds or how good everyone thinks that person is. We are all sinners in need of God's redeeming. And that person's faith, which is a gift from God, may inform them to live their lives in a way that responds to the good news of Jesus Christ. But that's not why they're saved in Jesus Christ. Because salvation is alone from God. God alone is good. Not even Jesus will dare say he is good. It's a pretty humbling point in that gospel reading. But then the final part of this gospel reading for today is that when one is called to follow Jesus Christ and give up everything to follow, don't assume automatically that's going to result in blessings for your life. Right? Remember those lovely disciples? If they knew they were going to endure what they were going to endure, do you think they'd sign up for it again? Right? They faced persecution, suffering. They had their own failures. And pretty much all of them eventually died. They were murdered for witnessing to Jesus. It was not a single minute of their lives that was made easier because they followed the way of Jesus Christ. So on one hand, we clearly recognize the weight of the law and the things we have turned into idolatry, worshiping them as many gods. We recognize that by ourselves, none of us can keep the law. By ourselves, it is impossible. And none of us, including Jesus, is good. All of us have riches we hold on to our lives, wealth, power, control, etc., to varying degrees. And when we follow Jesus, we will not be exempt from hardship, persecution, suffering, pain, or death. Have I depressed you all enough yet? But the good news, there's good news, right? We're waiting for the good news. The good news is that there is still grace in this gospel reading for today. Like Jesus looked at that rich man with love, Jesus looks upon each one of us as prodigal sons and daughters in God's kingdom with unconditional love and forgiveness. And each day is a new day in Christ to be called to something different, to be radically changed. And when I say radical, I mean rooted. Rooted in God, rooted in Jesus Christ. That when we are anchored and rooted in Christ, we are rooted in God's unconditional love and forgiveness. That brings life for the world in his kingdom. And in response to the gift of faith, because we receive salvation from Christ freely, we live in response to the gift of faith to trust and believe and let go of the control. Right? I don't know about you, but certain situations, when I finally let go of the control, life gets a lot easier. Sometimes, not always. But sometimes situations, it just gets easier. And to find ways in our words and actions to build up the kingdom of God and to bring life to God and to our neighbor. And that even in the times when we do even the most smallest things that seem ordinary to us, God and Jesus Christ can make the impossible possible. That each day as we kneel before God in confession of where we fall short of the glory of God, we are given a new opportunity for wholeness and healing, a second, a third, a fourth, a fifth chance over and over again to live in the abundance of life in Jesus Christ, in his grace, and to share this abundant life for the building up of the kingdom of God, to bring life to others. And that indeed, my sisters and brothers in Christ, is definitely good news, for the kingdom of God is near. Thanks be to God, and all God's people say,
amen.
Amen. Let's take a moment of silence to reflect on God's holy word. Please stand. We will continue with our hymn of the day, hymn 406 in your Lutheran Book of Worship, hymn 406, verses 1, 2, and 4. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we boldly profess our faith. I believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. May children and heirs of God's promise, we pray for the church, the world, and all in need, responding, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Uniting God, you call forth different gifts in those who follow you. Encourage us to welcome the diverse benefits and blessings of the whole church in teaching, preaching, prophecy, healing, and more. Lord, in your mercy. Nurturing God, you bring forth crops from the soil and bounty from the trees. Increase the produce of the land and bless all those who toil in the fields and orchards. Provide good working conditions and keep them safe. Lord, in your mercy. Empowering God, you offer compassion for those who are overlooked or forgotten. Open the hearts of local, national, and world leaders to show such compassion and love for their neighbors. Lord, in your mercy. Sheltering God and Jesus, you have traveled among us without a place to lay your head. Provide safe places to sleep and rest for those who have no place to live. The same ministries that offer food, clothing, and peace of mind. Lord, in your mercy. Healing God and Jesus, you are a great physician and healer. Bring healing and wholeness to all in body, mind, and spirit, especially Gaylord, Charlie, Steve, Patty, Charlotte, Keith, Chase, Coralie, Ken, Irma, Kathy, Jacqueline, Larry, Nancy, Taylor, and Tyler, Zeno, Ginny, Sophie, Janet, Fred, Jackie, Richard, Lenny, Sue and Ed, Brittany, Parker, Dorothy, Sharon and Steve, Susan, Carl, Helen, Patty, Marion, Veronica and Bill, Margaret, Dwayne and Patty, Betty and Larry, and Marilyn. Lord, in your mercy. Renewing God, you bring out life out of death. Help us bring with those things that are no longer beneficial to us and open our hearts to see where new life is budding in this congregation. Lord, in your mercy. God of wisdom, we pray for guidance as we discern where your Holy Spirit is guiding us. We remember before you our call committee members, that your Holy Spirit be upon each of them as they help search for a new pastor to shepherd and guide this faith community. Lord, in your mercy. Eternal God, we thank you for the lives of those who have died, especially Stannon, Dawn, Carolyn, Steve, Rebecca, and Darren. Make us confident in your promise of salvation and support us in your own journey of faith. Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers, O God, and those in our hearts known only to you through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also
share the peace with one another. This is the time we normally would collect our offering. Thank you all for dropping off your offering or mailing it in or sending it electronically. Thank you to all of you, both in person and online, who share your time, talents, and gifts to the ministries of St. John Lutheran Church by helping those who are in need. Let us pray. God of abundance, you cause streams to break forth in the desert and manna to rain from the heavens. Accept the gifts you have first given us. Unite them with the offering of our lives to nourish the world you love so dearly. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
I invite you now to take your communion cups. Go ahead and loosen the first layer to receive the host, and the second layer to get to the grape juice. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should all times and all places offer thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn, Holy, Holy, Holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. And again after supper, he took the cup, and giving thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in the remembrance of me. Let us pray together as our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace. I invite you now to take your bread, the host. This is the body of Christ, which is given for you. Amen. And with your grape juice, this is the blood of Jesus Christ, which is shed for you. Amen. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen. Lord, now you let your servant go in peace. Your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you prepare in the sight of every people, a light to reveal to nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Let us pray. Lord of life, in the gift of your body and blood, you turn the crumbs of our faith into a feast of salvation. Send us forth into the world with shouts of joy, bearing witness to the abundance of your love in Jesus Christ, our Savior and our Lord. Amen. Amen. Receive God's blessing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Amen. We continue with our ascending hymn. Hymn 260 in our Lutheran Book of Worship.
Thank you.
Go in peace. Share the good news.
Thanks be to God.
Have a blessed week, all. I will see you in 2 weeks.